every launch party, I seem to have trouble, getting people's attention or reader, and I don't know, it just never occurred to me until this year. Maybe we should use a mic. So we've got a mic now, so hopefully that helps everyone, especially you in the back here. So welcome. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. A little milder weather than last year. Last winter, we had a huge snowstorm. It was crazy, so really nice not having that tonight. So thank you for coming out. Just a little introduction to Qua for those of you who are not so familiar with us. We are U of M Flint's student-run literary and fine arts magazine. So our whole staff is students, but our contributors are anybody. Our mission, we're Flint publication first. We publish anybody. We actually have some art from someone in Japan. We have writers from California. So we try to have really good broad diversity with our writers. But our main focus, we are Flint first. We do most of our promotions around Flint. We hold our launch parties right here in Flint. So that is our mission, is to promote the work of writers, especially writers who are and artists that are trying to get their work out there. But we are also use a completely blind review process too. So a lot of the bigger publications, the Paris Review, they want your resume, they want to know what other, where else you've published. So it's kind of like, okay, you need the experience to get published, but how do you get that experience if you need the experience to get published? So that's one really great thing about us. We're completely blind. We don't know who submits unless we accept you, so that's another thing. If you are interested in submitting for our next issue, there's no risk because we don't know who you are unless we accept you. And if we accept you, then yay, it's exciting. All the quads out have our information on how to submit to our next issue. And our next issue is really exciting. It's our 50th anniversary. So Quad has been around for 50 years. So our next issue will be our 50th anniversary issue. We're going to have a really big party celebration. We actually already have a space reserved in the Flint Farmers Market for that one. So save the date, April 28th. It's a Thursday evening. It'll be really exciting. We're going to have a lot of past editors, past contributors coming, talking, sharing stories. We're going to get history. So it'll be really cool. Another way to keep up on our events and our submission deadlines and guidelines and all that, we have a Facebook page, Qua Magazine. Like us if you haven't already. We have a website, quamagazine.com. That's also all in the very back of Qua, all that information. So definitely check us out. We actually just revamped our whole website, so we have all of our past issues on there. Videos, shorts that some of you of our students have made, all of our past art, everything is up on the website. So definitely check that out. So there is that. So I want to go through our contributors. Actually go through our schedule first to give you an idea of how everything's going to work. We're actually going to do our game first tonight. We have a little game to kind of get us warmed up and into the spirit, so I'll explain that in a minute. Then we'll have our readers. We'll have each reader come up and read. We'll hold the questions and comments for the end, and then we'll ask, whatever questions for anyone that we have at that point. So I would like to take this time to thank everybody who put all the hard work and effort in that makes Qua possible every semester. It is pretty much, from the very beginning of the semester until tonight, just nonstop. There's so many different pieces that go into this. First, I want to thank, in the front row here, we have Holland Lund. She is our designer of this beautiful issue. Our designer designed not just the cover, but the entire thing, the layout, everything. You have no idea how much work goes into this. It's not just designing, it's taking all of the content, putting it in, and having to all the nitpicky details and edits, and she put in hours and hours and hours and hours. I mean, it definitely shows. And this is our printer called this one the Cadillac of our quad issues. So everyone, please give Helen a round of applause. Our web designer, Nick Loomy, but he puts in a ton of work. He's done really great work for our website. So I'm very, very thankful to have him because I'm so illiterate when it comes to web design or anything like that. And we have our advisors, which I have not seen Katie yet. She has been on maternity leave this semester. She just had a baby. Months ago, yeah, so I'm not surprised that she's not here right now, but she's also like a huge push behind everything. She's the reason why Quad keeps getting better and better every semester, because she just really pushes us to be our best, and when I, you know, things that I don't think would be possible, she sees the possibility and pushes me towards it. So really, we couldn't be where we're at without Katie Curnow. And Ben Gatos working directly with Helen, helping a ton with the design side of it. So there's no way that any of this could happen without our advisors. Next I'd like to introduce our prose and poetry editors of this issue, Breck and Nick, stand up. These are our prose and poetry editors. You want to give them a round of applause? They are the ones that are in charge of going, you know, like, talking. So all of our prose and poetry people who are here, that's who you've been talking to. They do all the editing, really working on a lot of that. So they're putting a lot of time and effort. As well, we have our assistant editors that work with them. Megan is here. She's our assistant prose editor. She's actually taking over for Brock, who's graduating this semester. So she's our newest prose editor for our winter semester. So she's here. Ashley could not make it, so Megan. Relly, who just walked in, she's our marketing coordinator this semester, so she's the one behind all the Facebook posts and helping get the word out for all of our call for submissions, the launch party, passing out flyers, and just helping get the word out about Quad, because if nobody knew about us, nobody submitted, nobody came, then what would be the point, right? So round of applause for Relly. Readers who read, we get over 200 submissions every issue. They read everything for us and give us feedback on, you know, who we should accept into the issue. So definitely couldn't do it without them either. It's a huge, you know, group effort. And then Regal Press and Davison does all our printing for us, and they actually worked over the weekend to make sure we got it in time for tonight, so they've been really great to work with as well. And then, of course, Buckham Gallery lets us hold our events here for free, so really are thankful for them. If you would like to donate anything to the gallery, it helps them out a lot. There's a couple small buckets back there under that clock, and there's also a bigger glass one back by the entrance. So that's there as well. And I'd also like to say thank you to the Flint Student Publication Board. They provide us all the funding for these issues, and a lot of the guidance as well. So I think thanks to everybody, and of course all our supporters. So without further ado, we'll get into the games. So okay, so this can be done. And while everybody's reading, we'll compile the scores and we'll do the products at the end. So feel free to grab some food. We've got sparkling juice also while we're doing the game, and we'll reconvene in about 15 minutes or so for all the readings. So I will set these up here, and you guys can come up and grab one, and then you can work in groups, you can work by yourself. I'll grab some pens, and we'll reconvene in about 15 minutes or so.
Sometimes play percussion on the walls with wrecking balls, with glass symbols to use up. So that could make a teacup red with the green. It's not quite the same, but nothing will pass the same danger. They strap me to the iron hook with rusty chains that turn my arms orange. I confuse the rotten metal by my brain, almost pleasantly. The ground shakes and rappers rattle as the machine activates. My friends are plugged in as we crack jokes while we play. The one behind the control panel speeds the ride faster than normal. We've almost gotten bored. The hook clatters with the resonance shrill enough, and the crane growls under the strain of its sharp contortions. I'm a ragdoll in the mouth of a German shepherd. Something inside tears at my stomach, says I'm in bad company. I decide to look for a way out after this turns up. I look behind the buildings and wander into older ones, if older ones are possible. Apparently they are. These are made of wood, the floorboards soft as sponge. Everything is desert dry. I pull one up. Underneath the crawl space. The ground is all sawdust. I step down and begin to crawl, squirming through the inner space. The boards start to dig in my back. Everything closes in. The space is too small now. Too small to go back or move forward. Stuck. On the boards, the friends locate my position. They taunt me for wanting to defect. There's nowhere to go. Malice laughter. The kind of old engineers, old veterans, and old drunks give up. Can't handle it. This is all there is. I can't move. They light a match. It falls into the crawl space, igniting the sawdust. The walls catch and rafters burn. Smoke fills the whole place. I can't breathe. He rushes me, jumps down my throat as I scream for help. I'm aware how silly it is, but I do it anyway. From instinct, probably. My eyes sting like that was an alcohol. They melt. I melt. My friends laugh. They're pretty funny. Now the limit on the world, named by a four-letter word, arranges itself such that sense falls through it like water through a sieve. Life's a need that's been not satisfied but displaced. The subject never changes. My eyes see expanse, but not the sea entire. Only its first impressions. And never did they get beyond the hellos. I see holes composing history, gaps moving planets, space in a black corset. And that feeling I always had, that this was always what was happening, is finally justified again.
Because he was not a sonnet, or a free verse, or anything at all resembling poetry. He was a poet.
broke a chain or freed a human soul. And this poem is about a southern woman who changed her mind. I spied her through the kitchen window, walking up the hollow. Casserole cradled in red oven mitts, cheese grits, I guess, with her low country seasoning mixed in. Southern pride reaching like a mist over blue mountain streams that meander under great white oaks, their backs arched, overreaching, like Tennessee Williams, Faulkner, Honshaloo, Capote, Hurston, Welty, Ellison, and McCullers, truth tellers all. I looked up over the window at the tacks, plucked them out one by one, and lowered the faded stars and bars before she hollered at my back door.
Yeah.
Talk of microbrews and Indian pale ales, espresso steams and thoughts. A natural phenomenon envelops their conversation, abstract and nonsensical. Their movements fluid and sync. They are familiar, and I am a stranger, sitting alone, waiting. Yeah.
Stories from him, and I had it for like a year, and I never The letter B has become optical, its tape reflecting your glasses. The negative spaces have turned to nests, cupping your carved eyes that death dropped in flight. It is the spine of a thick Steinbeck that stares from my shelf, rods and cones bound in the same gray and blue hues of the walls of your study. The armchair is fully clad by the bedroom window. I sit on the edge of your side, a riverine stone. It is too neatly made. It is too still, that black line. How it fades to breaking to a clap of your laughter when my eyes close. Let me rebuild you, if only for a day. A green spreader spilling chalky beads, six cigars stuck as candles, hissing their sweet smoke into the air. And now a yellow rose from your gray feet, a bloom that blew the stars to misalignment with its extreme beam of color. It must be a monstrous thing, that black vulture, always suckling my shadow, the anvil that slept on my coattails for a summer. It must be to have lifted your marble body, wings of soft tissues taut, carrying you away, away. No one stands steady in the gust you had blocked, my colossus. What a disoriented dynasty, pure windrip, shocks piled on our heads of fog. We are streaming ties and shrouding ourselves in your shirts to cry. Son, daughter, wrapped twice in 2 years, she felt you today. My grandmother, chipped from emerald, holding onto your cane. Her sparkle stalls for a moment or two, your jewel ball jewels, channeling with a wooden avenue, but there are so many pieces of you. So I put back your eyes, softly on your desk, next to maps, ships, busts, the hung sunset to my back. Our shaken give and take will survive you, I've decided. I will borrow your Shakespeare, your last living loan to me. A molten slide of gold is filling the footsteps of a storm, and I see it as you, and I'm silver, sentinel of debris, the black line stirring on its silo bait at the summit of a mountain of books. Tumbleweed, history. Yes, that is what you'll be.
Crazy man. He was not thunderously alive with bells and rainbow ribbons. He was not funny or awkward or ridiculous or special. I cannot speak as to his character. What was left, you might ask. You might be able to tell from my tone that there was a certain severity in this moment when I sat down across from him thinking that I was about to enter a somewhat interesting conversation. A young, unassuming black man and myself, who were located in a psych ward that did not let its patients go outside during any part of the day. Maybe now you are pondering something that resembles the timelessness of the gut, something like the beauty of an old house in a state of decay. These exact words serve as a preservation of something I know, yet will never be able to express completely. As a poet, I seek to preserve the moment and tap the drum of intense focus. I cannot speak as to the power of this man. Maybe one day in the past he possessed something loud and blood red. Maybe he said something no one had ever said before and surrendered himself to the fact of his theory. I have no idea, because whatever it was that made this man who he was also erased his ability to form words. As a thought escalated to the bottom of his throat and disappeared inside its own effort, he looked me in the eyes and smiled.
Do you have any other prose or poetry to be here that is on page 62.
So spirea is a type of bush. And there was much debate between my aunts and uncles about what particular bush was situated outside of my grandparents' house, which you can see through a picture window. After a couple phone calls and much debate, like I said, it was decided that spirea was what it was. And as a poet, you can imagine the word spirea was better than bushes. The spirea is frantic in the wind, green fingers with white flowers that look like popcorn floating on waves against a spring sky, blue, like the way I envisioned it in the winter every time I pulled on wool socks. Thank you.
Did I miss anybody else? Don't be shy. Okay, is Christian here? An artist, Christian. Would you like, you said maybe you wanted to speak, so you can or you can. It's up to you.
Just briefly, I guess.
Sure. Okay, Road Fox on page 71.
So I was this is actually my first year submitting for Qua, because I was planning on doing it the year before, but as soon as I remembered to get down to it, it was like an hour straight after the deadline. I was like, oh no. So here I am this year. I'm very grateful to have something accepted into a magazine before, because I'm very humble, very modest, believing that I can always improve on my work, that I'm not anything special, really, despite what a lot of people tell me. So, and I'm also used to critiques where I'm not the only one talking about my work, but there's like other people, whether they're giving comments or giving feedback. So if you had any questions or any words of advice to help me improve on my craft, I would appreciate that as well. But basically, like, foxes are my favorite animal. This piece was inspired by just like how people will joke around with pets or animals and like dress them up, maybe put glasses or big goofy hats on them. So I figured I'd just do like a little portrait on 9x12 paper. And this is all graphite. I used a reference photo just to understand fur patterns and make sure that nothing looked too off. I did want to abstract a little bit just to kind of show off the goofy flashiness of the character, because he's already wearing glasses. You see in the reflection of the glasses, he's in like a desert, assuming that he's riding on a motorcycle down the road, so. And then I used a photo editing software on my Android to add an even like a slight color effect to it, just to kind of add a little more flair to it, so.
What inspired this wonderful piece that we included here?
Oh, it was all the controversy surrounding the stars and bars, the Southern flag. There were so many different ideas floating around, and I just decided to take the point of view of someone who had changed her mind, because it's hard for Southern people to change their minds, and they want to stay locked in the past, and that tradition is so important to them. So I thought, what would it be like if someone did change their mind?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really like the piece.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions? I have a question. question for Rachel. I love your little short poems and
your tiny poems.
So, because they're short, I mean, it looks like I'm sure there's a lot more that goes into it. Like, is it something that just comes to you, or how long does a tiny poem take for you?
It usually takes me like a whole day to craft it. Like, I think about it all day. But one of the things that I like to think about is the way that when I read like any kind of novelist or any kind of prose piece that allows you to like fill in the blanks yourself. It's kind of how I think about it. Like I allow people I just kind of say what I have to say about what things look like, and then I let everybody else kind of fill in their own. And I think it's important to say what you need to say in the least amount of words possible.
It takes a special talent to be able to have such a tiny poem with so much craft and so much in it, and I love your tiny poems. So.
Thank you. I just think about stuff before you write it a lot. That's what I mean. I think about it a lot before I put it in words.
So there's few words but less. Less in between the words. So.
Thank you.
Other questions?
I'm always interested in what the poetry comes out of, what inspires people. So maybe I'd put that to Molly. You know, what inspired poetry?
It's a personal piece. It was written about a guy who just didn't measure up.
It was just a boy.
Yeah.
And I'll just monopolize on the time. Same question about Pison.
Pison is about my boyfriend, which I think it comes off as a very negative movie. It's not so not meant to, I guess, that is some questions for everything. But we had a very long relationship a couple years ago. It's just meant to basically emphasize the self-sacrifice in a relationship, and that it's not, even though it sounds, and I know it sounds horrible, and it sounds maybe like death, basically, but it's not, it can be a positive poem, despite the wording, it really is.
I know I can't be the only one with questions. There's so many great pieces here.
I have a question.
I'm sorry. This is Katie. This is our advisor that I always talk about. An experience, or that's kind of a question. I'm sorry.
I was hospitalized in a psych ward in 2004. And I don't know, I'm sort of interested in interpersonal relationships and what you expect or what you think might be attributed to someone, or what someone else is, or who they are, or how they are, and then your reaction to what it is when you find that out. So I took advantage of that idea.
Yeah, I liked how your title, Crazy Man, was in quote, like that, you know, like crazy man, you know.
Yeah, I hate crazy. I hate that word. It's dismissive, mm-hmm. you know. So you know, it's a tremendous injustice for people to just sort of label someone as crazy, and I think, it can mean a lot. It can mean many different things, and some people who are crazy have just been worn down so much by personal pain, or you know, by not necessarily by their own little world, but by the injustice or by how they are treated and how they suffered, and then that's thought of as crazy. So I have a problem with that.
Yeah, so I really like that about your poem, that it takes a completely, you know, different perspective into a person's life and giving that person their humanity back that, you know, was kind of taken away by words like crazy. So I appreciate that about your poem.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
Is Mark calling?
He is not. I'm disappointed because he was going to read. Did you have a question about his story or his poem?
I have a question about his story.
His story. I know. I would love to ask him about it too.
I plan to give him massive amounts of trouble for not being here.
I know.
I just saw him at the library even like 3 days ago, and he said he was going to be here. So.
Final blessing you.
Plenty of.
Yeah, I'm curious about his, I don't know, most of you have not read it yet, obviously, but I'm curious about his, if he had any kind of influence, because it reminds me of some writers, so I have to ask and pass along. Any other questions or comments? Okay, I want to, before I give up the prizes for our game, I'd love to give another round of applause to all of our contributors. Okay, so we have a three-way tie. We didn't have anyone get all 16, but we do have three teams that got 15 out of 16. So I am impressed because I tried to make these really hard, so you guys did awesome. So, Nick, do you want to draw for me? So we're going to draw, but we're going to do third, second, and first place. We'll do third place first. You'll come up, got three. Prizes here, and the second place can either steal the prize that third place pick or pick another one and then save the first place. So, draw for third place here.
Get a drum roll. Get a drum roll. Okay. Third place goes to IDK. Give her a round of applause.
Really
shiny.
best friend. Journal and some pens. Round of applause one more time.
Okay, for second place, can you get that drum roll? Second place goes to. Second place goes to Knight Who Says Knee. Yeah, go to Knight Who Says Knee. Okay, so before you go to press, you can either steal her gift, and then she gets to pick a new one, I believe, or you can get a brand new prize. That's his brother right there.
One more time, do it for all of our winners.